I share a painting of me with Moses at the parting of the seas. And you can see my bevia right at the foot of my where my legs are. And after that event was over, I was going to head over to work with my bees. So as you can see, I've been keeping bees for a long, long time. But in all fascination, here I am at 4 years old, almost five, with my dad, my mentor. He got me into beekeeping at a very young age, and I'm sixth generation beekeeper, so I've been at it a long, long time. My family's been at it going back to Poland. So there we are. You start off young, and I'm still at it, and I've got my 120 hives still operating. But anyway, if you look into a beehive and open up a beehive, you're going to see 80,000 bees all of a sudden just looking up at you. There was little brown eyes all looking up. And that's why we have to use a smoker to deter them a little bit until they know we're not hurting them. So what we do is beekeepers, we put pine needles or wood chips in here, get a little smoke, go and smoke them. That makes them think there's fire in the hive. They go down and start eating honey because they know they're going to have to leave, and they take the honey. In the meantime, we get into the hive, start working. They see we're not hurting the bees, and they let us work them. I can keep my hive open for an hour, and the bees go out doing their own thing. And very docile, you have to know when. They don't want bad weather. They don't want you opening their home. You wouldn't either. So if you don't want to be squashed, they don't want to be rattled, there are certain ways to work. As a beekeeper, you'll get to learn that. And many beekeepers learn the hard way. You know, bees will sting, but they're very reluctant. The honeybee, like the yellow jacket wasp and hornet, has a barb on its stinger. When it stings you, it pulls out, pulls its intestine out, and dies. So it's sacrificing its life. The wasp hornets can multiple sting and still live. So the honeybee, but they will die for the hive. If you threaten their hive, they will sting you. And of course, does it hurt? Everybody asks me, does it hurt? Because some people have never been stung. It hurts. When that venom hits the bloodstream, ow! Second, you don't go stop doing what you're doing, ow! And before you know it, they spread this pheromone, defense pheromone, throughout the hive. And guess what that means? Attack.
Yeah.
And that's their way of protecting themselves, the honeybees. So you look up at, you know, like you said, 80,000 honeybees. When you open a hive, it's pretty frightening for a new beekeeper. You know, for a novice that has never been into bees, 80,000 bees looking up at you is a scary thing, but there's nothing to be scared of. You learn how to do it the right way, you will be able to. Now, a hive, the bees in a hive, and what I have there is that observation hive, that's one of 10 sections. 10 sections like that make up a beehive. And what they do is they go in a 3-mile diameter gathering pollen and nectar, the two foods that they need. It's reciprocal. We need the honeybees, they need us. They don't need us, I guess, but the plants, and the plants we plant, because what they need, the adult bees need the nectar, which is carbohydrates to them, and they need the pollen, which is high protein. The pollen is very high protein. I had a friend once take a lot of CP, about that much, just hibernate all day. It's very high protein, and so they use this to feed the young, so the young grow strong. And the honey, the nectar, they turn into honey, and the adult bees eat that. That gives them the energy to heat the hive in the winter time to make 90 degrees in there, creating energy, rubbing their thoracic muscles so they can keep it at 90. It gives them energy to fly. I was just the other day, a friend of mine, and I went up to his hive. He said, Ken, we started 2 years ago. This is the second year. He said, Ken, there's something wrong in the hive. He said, the bees are hardly moving. They just, well, I went into the hive. Guess what? There wasn't a stitch of honey in the hive. They were starving to death. I says, you know why? You got to feed them. So we as beekeepers have to know what we need to do, because the bees do need help. They're pretty self-sustaining for the most part, but we have to know when to intervene in the hive. So they gather in a 2 to 3 3 mile area, and when they do that, guess what? They're pollinating all of our crops. They're pollinating everything out there in that 3 mile area. And people don't have bees in the area, they'll know, because they won't have much fruit, they won't have much berries, they won't have any vegetables, because the pollination isn't being done. And you won't have the nice fruit that's pollinated, so that's really well pollinated. So that 3 mile area, they fly, and you can see the bees go to each, they know exactly where to go, which flowers have nectar, which flowers have pollen for them, and they'll go to those sources. And in the hive, you can see, it's made up of three types of bees. Here on the right are the worker bees. Those are all females whose female ovaries haven't developed, so they can't be impregnated and be queens. But they're all females. They do all the work in the hive. 95 to 96% are worker bees. They do all the work, all the chores. In the middle is the drone. The drone is the male bee. There's only 4 to 5% male bees. They're only there for one purpose. It's like a voice call. And the female needs to be mated. They go out and do their thing. And like I said, you know, the female, a new queen is hatched. We'll get more into the queen in a minute, but new queen is hatched. She needs to be mated, not to be fertile, to lay fertile eggs. And so she goes on the mating flight, and then all the drones follow. They want to be the ones to mate with the queen. And usually she'll mate anywhere from 8 to 15 drones over the course of 4 or 5 days. And then she's mated for life. And of course, she mates in flight, not in the hive. A lot of people misconception. She mates in flight, and the drones fly after her, mount her, and of course, then that beyond that gets into my X-ray to talk about bees, and you people are a little too young for that. And on the far left is the queen. She's the lifeblood of the hive. You'll see her in a minute in better pictures. She's larger. She's twice the length of a worker bee. A little more than twice the length. Not quite as wide as a drone, but a long, thin abdomen. That's what really identifies her. And she lays 1,200 eggs a day. Amazing. She stays day and night, takes an hour break here and there, but day and night just laying eggs. Because don't forget, bees die in summer months from March to October. They die every 6 weeks. They only have a 6 week lifespan. So she needs to replace all those bees in order to keep the numbers in that hive. And so she's a busy girl. That's all she does. They feed her, they groom her, they take care of her. She just goes on. You're going to see some photos here in a minute that my friend took. But anyway, in that hive, it's a host of activity. The bees that come in with the nectar, a bee is a house bee or a field bee. The first 2 weeks of their life, they're house bees. They stay in the hive. They don't move out of the hive. They're 2 weeks not strong enough to fly yet. After 2 weeks, they become field bees. They go and get the nectar and pollen. So you can see here on the left, by the way, that's a real good close-up. My friend took some of these photos. He's a photographer. And the one on the left is the field bee. Came back, and here's the house bee. The house bee takes the nectar out of the honey stomach of the field bee and deposits it in the cells of the frame. And we'll see some close-ups of that in the house bee. So they work together as a team. When a field bee comes in, the house bee gets right there, takes the nectar from the field bee, and then deposits it and turns it into honey. Now, there's the guard bees. The guard bees, they're bees that are older, over 2 weeks old. They just stay at the entrance. They guard the hive, making sure that no other bees come into the hive. They got a little gland. It's called a Mazanoff gland. That has the smell of the queen. All of them have that same smell. Every bee in that hive smells the same. And when foreign bees come in, they don't have that smell. They'll attack it. They'll chase it right off. A bumblebee tries getting in, they'll chase it off. A mouse tries getting in, they'll chase it off. They'll sting if they have to. They'll start biting at first, but then the stinger, And so the guard bees do an important job, because it's like anything else. In the bee world, if hive don't have any honey of its own, guess what? They try to rob. They try to survive. And so the guard bees do a chore. Then there's the house cleaning bees. They clean everything in that hive, keep it spotless, polish up all the cells that the queen's going to lay in. Then the water gathering bees. They gather with water, just like every creature. Bees need water. But the house bees can't get water because they don't fly out. So what happens is the water gathering bees go out, collect the water, bring it back, give it to the house bees, and if it's too hot, see, now in the hive, in that hive, it's a world, they got to keep it at 93 degrees. In order to raise their young, 93 degrees. If it gets much over 95, they'll suffocate. If it gets much under 90, the bees will chill. You'd say, 90 chill, yeah. Bees need a temperature of 90 to mature. And so they keep that temperature right there between 90 and 95. They're perfect. They eat honey, produce heat. Now, when it's too hot, what happens? The water bees bring in water, put water all in throughout the hive, and all the bees fan. And it cools, a cooling effect. And they move it right through the hive to cool down the temperature. They can control that. It amazes me. It's amazing that they're better at heating and cooling a house than any creature I know. They're just amazing that little insects like that can bring the temperature 20 below outside, bring it up to 90 in there. How do they do it? You know, but they have to have a lot of honey. You have to leave them a lot of honey. Now, there's the close-up of the bee. See, isn't she cute, that worker bee? Little brown eyes, blonde hair. And there you can see a nurse feeding the young larva. Inside there, they chew up the pollen, the nectar, and they feed the larva, and the larva grows big and strong because the pollen and the nectar together is called bee bread, bee food. And they put some enzymes from a gland in the back of the head, and they feed the young, so they grow big and strong. And so there's a whole group of chores that the worker bees do. Everything that's needed to be done, they work together. Here's the male bee, the drone. Like I said, they wait. When their virgin queen's ready to be mated, off they go into the, it's called drone zones, where the drones all congregate, and the queens will go to get mated. It's, they've been defining about 150 feet up, they're called drone zones. And the drones will all congregate during certain hours of the day, they stay there, and virgin queens will head up to be mated. So that's the drone. And there's the queen, the largest of the bees in the hive. You can easily find her because she's much larger. And most people will mark her with a white mark on the back of her thorax. So you can find where she is. And if you have to replace her, you can find her easily. But you notice all the court, her court all around her, grooming her, feeding her, taking care of her. All she'll do is put her head in, check the cell to make sure that it's clean, that it's polished. And then she lays the egg. By the way, that's magnified. A friend of mine took this photo as well, magnified. And I happened to take the queen out. And just as I took her out, she was releasing the egg from the whole closet. We've got a great shot there. But that's magnified. Picture a thread. You know how a white thread, how thin it is? 1/80th of an inch. That's how small. It's like a rice grain. You have to look, really strain your eyes to see the eggs in the hive. And like I said, 1,200 eggs a day, she just keeps going, like a machine. And of course, you can see the little baby larva hatched out in 3 days after the egg is laid. And 3 days, the little larva is hatched out. See the eggs all here, laid, right to the bottom of the cell. And then in 3 days, they hatch into a wild, and that's when all the nurse bees come into action, chew pollen, nectar, feed the little larvae, so they grow big and strong. And then they grow in the cells, they get bigger and bigger, crystalline white. And then after 7 days, they cap it over with a wax capping, and underneath there, the bee turns into a pupa. And in 21 days, the little bee, you can see, they're chewing its way out. struggling, just like a chick pecking its way out of its shell, this little bee is struggling to chew its way out, come into the world. And often with friends or whatever, new beekeepers are so worried about their bees. I said, oh. And they said, what? And I take tweezers and pull aside the cappings, and the little bee walks out, takes his first breath, and flexes those wings and takes that first. Amazing to see that. And I say to them, oh, it's a girl. And they say, how do you know? I said, it's a worker bee, foolish. And they're all girls. But you can see, isn't she cute? Little brown eyes, blonde, that's what they look like when they first come out of the cell. And that one I gave the name of Susie. And that's the cycle they go through. It's a 21-day cycle. From egg to bee hatching, 21 days. And then after 2 weeks in the hive, they go out collect the nectar. They got long tongues. They stick it down into the flower, suck up the sweet nectar that's 80% water. When I do my, at the Harvard schools I do for third and fourth graders, I do sessions where I do interactive stuff. I give them straws. And what they do is give them a jar of sugar syrup with flour in it, and they have to do their wings, and they have to go suck up the nectar, and I put an empty frame on the other side of the room, and they have to go on and mimic what a bee does. They love it. It's a great activity. And in addition to that, multitasking, they take a little of the pollen, they attach these little tubes to them, they have to take some pollen, put it in their baskets, and fly back to the frame, and empty the pollen, empty the, and so it gives them the idea of what honeybees do. And then here's the pollen. They have these pollen baskets on their legs. On their hind legs, it's a pollen basket. And what the bees do is, as they go flower, flower, see all over the hairs, this pollen, and then with their tassels, they rake through that, put it right in the pollen basket, and this next bee here is flying back with pollen equal to its own weight. It'd be like you putting a human being on your shoulders equal weight and jumping off the ground. They fly back with that pollen that's equal their weight. And you can see all the little hairs, all that little pollen grains, when they go flower to flower, that's how they cross-pollinate. They cross-pollinate with those hairs into the flower, they're in there, and of course, it's not, hey, let's go out there pollinating because man needs food. They need the pollen for feeding the young. So it's a reciprocal relationship between man and insect. And you can see a pollen. It comes in different colors. Like I brought some this, tonight, I brought some maple pollen. They collected this from the maple trees. I trap it and I eat it myself. I take it every morning on my cereal, put pollen and then drizzle honey on that. Nothing like it. The maple pollen, you know, I like the best in the early spring, they get from the maple trees. It's a greenish gray color, so we can tell which, you know, type of pollen. And of course, they pack it in because they need to store it. You have to keep in mind, in the northern latitudes, they can't get it from November through March. They can't get any pollen or any nectar. Not until the beginning of March. The pollen's stocking around on maple trees, got cabbage, pussy willows. But during that interim period, they still gotta eat, feed their young. So they gotta have some stored. So they store about 25, 30 pounds of pollen, and they store about 80, 90 pounds of honey, nectar, that they turned into honey. And here you can see that area where they gather from. Crops that, a lot of crops out there that produce it. When they go to almonds out in California, there's hundreds of thousands of hives out there to pollinate the almonds. They're all competing for the pollen and the nectar. And here's a bee bringing back a house bee depositing the nectar in cells. And you can see, this is a whole frame I just took out here. I took all of my hives. I stole from these. And you can see the captive underneath that. You'll be able to come in hands-on after. All waxed over under here. I take an uncapping knife, spin, uncap it, spin it up, and nothing like fresh honey right out of the frame. And you can see, you know, a lot of people like the you know, like home honey that they eat in some preferred global climate. You can see the nectar of flowers comes in different colors, right? 4 or 5 different shades of colors. Buckwheat honey, which is molasses-like black, all the way to dandelion honey, which is yellow, and sweet pepper, which is almost like water white. So depending on what nectar, the color of the honey. And these bees are putting the nectar in all night. They'll fan to evaporate all that extra water, get the moisture up, and once it's under 18% water, they cap it over. Like you see here, just like you saw in that frame, they cap it over and they store it for winter months. They need 80 to 100 pounds here in the Northeast to survive the winter. That many bees. And you can see, they build their wax by using the honey. They eat the honey, and they got these wax glands. They ooze up these little flakes of wax, and then they take them with their mandibles, and they shape them into six-sided cells. Every cell is the same size. They're mathematicians, great mathematicians. With their mandible, they can tell how to build. They build all that wax out of the nectar and the honey. And here you can see a real close up of the honeybee. And on its back leg, instead of pollen, that's what we call propolis or propolis. They go to get saps from pine trees, propolis. They bring it back in and they stick up everything in the hive. For the winter, any cracks that they don't want in that hive, so the wind don't come in, rain, they seal it. It's like super glue. We need a hive tool in order to pry everything open. You can see, here's me here a few weeks back with my hives, and those are all beehives that are mine, and you can see, you need one of these to break it apart, because they glue everything up with propolis, they bring it back to the hive, and everything stuck up. At the end of the day, working with hives, your hands are like, you're trying to get them apart, it's like super glue. And they produce that. Now they found in recent years that propolis has medicinal qualities. I know in Europe, my grandfather, my father passed on to us, chewed the propolis, sore throat, it's gone. He'd make a tincture, poison ivy, my sister's poison ivy bed. My dad, they tried Calamine lotion, which didn't work back then. My dad says, took a little bit of vodka, put the propolis in there, made a thick sauerkraut of poison ivy. Next day, it was gone. Dr. O'Connor in our town, my sister went back to the doctor, how'd you do that, Walter? Well, you use propolis. After that, Dr. O'Connor was sending everybody to my dad to wear poison ivy. My dad would give him the sauce. It worked. Sure, I still to this day, I chew the propolis when I have sore throat. It's gone. It's amazing, the medicinal qualities in a beehive, we don't even know the algorithm. You know, different allergies and if everything goes right in that hive, you get just like this. This was the best year in 15 years for the nectar for the spring. I got one of my hives had over 100 pounds of honey. I got a banner, it's a banner here. I haven't seen one like this for 15 years. The spring fall. Now with the fall, we have 2 floors up in the Northeast. The spring flow is a big flow of nectar, water nectar from flowers, and then starting now, the golden rod, joint highway, there's another big flow. And the lighter honeys come in the spring, the darker honeys come in the fall. So you can see, if everything goes right, the first 2 boxes are where they live. They put their young, they store their honey, the pollen that they're going to need for winter. All these boxes on top are excess. So that's what we take out. And this frame that you see here is one. In each box, there are 10 frames like this. And we take them out, and that's all the extra that we can then uncap and eat for ourselves. I like to say borrow, but we're really stealing, you know?
So are all those boxes piled up? Would that be called one hive?
Yes, that's one colony, one hive, one beehive. And now, come to your question, once a year, they build a new queen. the way bees spread themselves, spread their population, is by making a new queen. And when she hatches, just before she hatches, the old queen takes half of the bees, 20,000, 30,000 bees. She leaves the hive to start a new nest. The young queen that hatches up is going to keep this nest running. And so what happens is she hatches out, in 3 or 4 days, she gets stronger. 3 or 4 days, she goes on mating flights, she gets mated, comes back, and she starts laying fertile eggs, keeps this nest going. And that's the way bees repopulate themselves in the environment out there. And that's when they swarm, what you see, you probably all saw a swarm. That's what I saw in Somerville when I went on that light fixture. Big, big swarm, just like that little light. And 30, 40,000 bees, I just took my bee and sprayed it, should have took bees, boom, they could all go in. And that's when you try to, beekeepers, if they manage well, they won't get swarms. You can manage your beehives, and that way you get more honey. And but, of course, swarms are a good thing because they spread the population of the bees throughout, especially these times when the bees are dying at alarming rates. Repopulating is good, except many of the feral colonies don't make it unless you manage the bees, the wild colonies. As a young man, I remember bee trees everywhere. Now, you're lucky to find one bee tree in the whole town. And that's a yellow jacket. Most bees get blamed. The honeybee gets blamed for stinging people. Because they see the yellow jacket, it looks like a honeybee, and they get stung. Oh, the honeybee stung me. But in most cases, the yellow jacket, the white-faced hornet, the wasp, they're aggressive. The honeybee is very reluctant to sting because it dies because of the barb sting. So as a result of that, the yellow jacket, I like to show people, there's no hairs on the yellow jacket, a bright yellow, black, little dots on the back abdomen. It's not that orangey color. And of course, that's my dad. We had 50 beehives for many, many years when he was working, and then I've increased it to 120 beehives just like that, the Polish colors, red and white. And that's, you can see here, you can see me right here, the guy in the shorts, last year. Which one? I had a dark one and now I'm light one. But with a whole list of county beekeepers out here, all listening to a program that we presented, that wanted to come out and see my beehives and see what I do with my beehives. So they all came out. We had 300 beekeepers that came out to my place to see my beehives. And I showed them how I manage my bees. And so that's where you, if you were to start beekeeping now, how would you start? Beekeeping is a hobby that many, last year in Worcester County, we had 350 people come to our bee school at UMass Medical School. Two auditoriums full, all getting into honeybees. They want the honey because of allergies, for pollination, because there's not many bees. So a lot of people are getting into it. Well, you get a cage of bees, 3 pounds of bees like this, and there'd be one queen in a cage. And what it is, I've watched many new beekeepers and helped them. I won't do it for them. I walk them through it. But when you get this package, and you've never had bees, you went to the bee school, but you've never seen live bees, this all of a sudden comes in the mail and arrives at the post office. Jennifer, you better get down here and get your bees. There's like 10,000 bees here. We want them out of the post office. And so you go down, and I can see they come back, you know, like this, very nervous. And then you set it down next to the hive, and what happens is this is a very, you'll never forget this experience as long as you live, to shake these bees into the hive. First of all, I want to watch them. They're shaking, they pry this little wooden lid on the top right off, and then most of the beekeepers, they're trembling. And all of a sudden, there's this cage hanging in here with a can of syrup that's kept them fed while they were traveling. And all of a sudden, what they have to do is they have to get this can out without letting the queen cage fall in to 10,000 bees. And so there's a trepidation, they get the can and get the queen out, then they put the lid in. Then they gotta take this queen, and there's some candy in here. They put this in the hive first, they set it in between the frames, and then the next big thing is the moment they'll never forget. They take thing and like this, empty all the bees. They say to me, is that enough? No, there's 100 more bees in there. Keep going. You know, like this. It, how's that? No, there's two more over the corner. Bag up here. And they finally get it, they put the cover on. And that breathtaking moment they never forget. In beekeeping, 20 years. I remember my first one I did at 7 years old. My dad let me shake my first package of bees. 7 years old, I went through the same experience. They were flying, because we were shaking, they all flying all around you. It's like a cloud of them before they settle down to where the queen is there, and your heart's pounding. I forget, Dad, is that enough? No. And that's what he did. There's two more up in the corner. You can't let them stuck in a cage. He says, hit the end of it. And I'm going like this. And he must have been laughing to himself, you know? And so anyway, I watch the movie. He was like, go up there, and I help him out. I say, okay, this is what you do. And that gives him a little more confidence. But that's how you start with your beehive. And the hobby involves then tending and taking care of that beehive, going in once a week, smoking them a little. So when you go every week, you go into the hive, you give them a little smoke. Then with this hive tool, you pry open the top cover. Give them a little smoke. And all of a sudden, one by one, you take out the frames to look at the queen's laying eggs, like you saw here, making sure that there's pollen and nectar. You give them sugar syrup in the beginning, because there's not many bees to collect the sugar syrup, the nectar yet, so you feed them sugar syrup, and they'll keep going, and all of a sudden you got a hive. And then comes the end of the season, every beekeeper, in our association, Ken, you think I'm going to get money? Well, don't count on it. Really? They all want honey. And of course, you know, I say sometimes, some years, like this year, they got honey. There's so many happy beekeepers out there. And not only that, with the honey, but now with the wax, as we uncap all this wax, take this knife, we uncap all this wax and spin the honey out, guess what? That wax is more valuable than the honey. The beeswax is more valuable than the honey. And so what do we do with all that beeswax? We make nice, beautiful candles. You know, it can make all shapes and sizes. It can make rolled candles, different colors for different holidays, red for Christmas, green for St. Patrick's Day, you know. And, you know, I took this. This was last year. I saw my, it was melting wax, and all of a sudden I saw my wife's guppy bowl on the TV. So I took the guppy out, put it into a honey jar. I didn't tell them, put the guppy jar on the counter. And then I took a fish bowl, poured the melted wax into the little guppy fish bowl. And it hardened, and it was in the thing. I said to her, I says, oh, look what I made. She said, you took my guppy bowl. I said, yeah. I says, I wanted to make a candle. She says, how are you going to get it out of there? I said, with a hammer. And she said, well, you're going to break it. I said, I know, but I got a nice candle. And so, not only that, but now more and more people, you'll be able to try this. Hand cream, beeswax, just wonderful product. It's pure beeswax, hand cream, lip balm. Did anybody use this? Okay, good enough. Beeswax soap, smell these out there when you come up here to check around. Beeswax, it's just wonderful. This is, I use this one right here. My wife, she likes this one right here. But this is pure beeswax and some honey in here. And make us feel, and you feel that. And then the newest trend is people making, oh, cooking with money. What's the kind of beekeepers on it? My dad and I for over 100 years of beekeeping. I'll picture that picture right on the front here. And you can cook all kind of recipes. My grandmother's, my great-grandmother's recipe, my mom's recipes in here. There's some other beekeeper's recipes in here. So you can cook with honey. I just made this over here, this apple butter with honey. Oh, it's just wonderful on toast, apple butter with honey. I decided to try it out. Oh, it spices up, just adds enough. I take honey and on my strawberry shortcake, I drizzle on the strawberries. Spring honey, which is very delicate honey. It's out of, I got some mint honey there. We got a farmer that produces 3 acres of mint. I put the hives in, I get mint honey. Be sure to try that one. And I drizzle that on the strawberries, and then on the whipped cream, and drizzle some pollen on the whipped cream. Oh, just wonderful. Oh, a chicken barbecue sauce, put honey in, and blend, cuts down that sharpness of it. Just a nice, when you bake the chicken with the barbecue sauce, mix the honey and the barbecue sauce and glaze it. Wonderful, wonderful. And then the latest trend is a lot of people are using their honey to make honey wine or mead. In Egypt, only the pharaohs could have mead. Only the pharaohs got all the honey in Egypt, which went to the pharaoh. But a lot of newest trend in beekeeping is they're making mead. This, which strawberry shortcake, this mead right here, sweet, nice sweet, Swedish sweet mead, this from dandelions. And oh, a little drink of mead and strawberry shortcake, it's a good blend to the palate of the mead. Or this is the sweeter one, this is the more dry mead. So depending on, you can make it many ways. You can make sweeter, make it more dry mead, but that's honey wine. And then my friend, this just discovered this, he tried, maybe made mint, jelly out of mead jelly. Not for kids, but this is mead jelly, and I'll let you try this after we do the honey tasting there. And of course, the hobby is kind of now, I make the comb honey. It's evolved into many different aspects, and a lot of people now keep bees for pollination, because wild bees aren't there. They keep bees for bee sting therapy. People with arthritis, I had a woman. I gave bee sting therapy. She came into the meeting like this, crippled up, and gave her bee stings. And of course, after 4 months, 5 months, not told, but she could move, she could knit again. She hugged me, she said, thank you, nothing helped her. And now she does it herself, because we cannot, unless you're a medical doctor, they can't administer it. But she comes and gets bees, and she stings herself, and she's so happy. She's got movement in her fingers, stings herself in the joints. And then, of course, a lot of people for allergies, honey from the local area, not processed. I get 72 customers that buy honey for allergies. They just 1 teaspoon a day, and they 80% to 100% gone. I taught for school for 38 years. I had probably 15 teachers, 2 principals, just use honey for allergies, work wonderfully. One, he was so bothered by allergies, after 3-4 months with me, he said, Ken, I wouldn't have believed this if I didn't do it myself. But I wouldn't have believed it. Thought it was hoax. And so, the hobby has evolved, and like I say, the good part about it is the bees. I just love them. On a sunny day, going out with my beehive, getting in there, forgetting about all your frustrations, your problems, and you just, on the side of a mountain, I was the other day on one of my beehives, and looking down into the river valley, there I am by myself, focused with the bees, just a wonderful day. And I know I'll keep bees the rest of my life, and I'll tell you, end it with this story. Sasha Kaplowicz from Blackstone, older gentleman, he had bees from a young man, he knew my dad. He had bees from, like I did, 4 or 5 years old. That was 5 years ago now. He was had to go in a nursing home. His wife and daughter said, Stash has to go in a nursing home. It's starting to let go. he wouldn't go without his honeybees. She said he wouldn't go. I went and talked to him. I went to the nursing home. They wouldn't let me put a beehive there. But I went to the farm across the street. I said, would you mind if I put a beehive here? There's a gentleman that's going to be coming in here. Oh, no, by no means. I went down to Blackstone. I said, Stosh, guess what? We can bring a beehive. Big smile on his face. He was willing to go to the nursing home. For a year and a half, he says, you'll take me to the beehive? I said, Stosh, doing the sun, spring, and summer. Once a week, I'll be by to get you. I'll never forget, for a year and a half, I'd go get him. I'd walk down the hallway. He'd see me coming, a big smile from ear to ear on his face. He was 93 years old. I'd come down and wheel him to the field, to the beehive, and he'd get to the beehive. I'd get the smoker going. He wanted to get up, lift the boxes up. He had no strength. It was near the end. And he was, I said, oh, no, Stosh, you just sit down. I'd find a queen. I said, here, find a queen for me. I need to find a queen. So he'd be looking, finding, looking for the queen. And I said, Stosh, you find her yet? Yeah, here she is, Ken. Oh, good. I need, and now what I need you to do is look through this room, see if you see any mites. These little mites on there. Look for them. Give him something. He just loved handling the bees. He loved them like I did from very young. And for a year and a half, some weeks I couldn't make it, he called, Ken, are you going to be down? I said, Stosh, I can't. I could feel the dejection in his voice. He disappointed. And after a year and a half, he was near the end already. He said, Ken, I asked you, because I know you're the only one that understands my love for bees, because you going through the same thing from a little boy. And he was near death at that point. And he said, I want you to have all my bees and my bee stuff. He says, please keep them alive for me. That's a big burden on me. But you know what? In South Grafton, hive number 5 was a big S on it. After 5 years, that hive is still alive. Every time I go there, I look up and I said, Stosh, thank you for keeping the hive alive. But he loved him so much, he wouldn't go to, he wanted to be there at his death. Matter of fact, 2 days before he passed on, he wanted me to take him out there. I started taking him back. Please, can I just sit here, watch him for a little bit more? And I'll never forget that moment. Can we just stay a little longer so I can sit here? There were tears in my eyes. I know he had only a couple that they told me. They didn't even want to unhook the IVs from him, but they did, which I'm glad they did, because that was the love of his life. And he ended his life, having been 2 days before he died. And I took everything, I got the hive. And so some people end up making a lifetime of it. Other people, 1-2 years. Anybody want to guess what the lifespan of a beekeeper is? Being a teacher, I gave the computer teacher a task for the advanced students. And they figured out what the lifespan from our membership was. 7.4 years is the lifespan of a beekeeper. But of course, some people like me, 60 some years, other people 1-2 years. But the lifespan, they go through a cycle, and it's not for everybody. But those that fall in love with it, stay with it for life. And I know a lot of them out there that are beekeepers for life, and they love their bees like pets. You can't do anything to that beehive. I had one just recently destroyed by a bear, a hive destroyed by a bear. This woman, she was in her 50s, was crying. She called me up. She said, Ken, could you come out here? I went out. That was in Grafton, to the same place with Stosh, not far from that nursing home. And I went out there. She's sitting with a beehive crying. The bear knocked it over and destroyed the whole thing, and she felt so bad. So she was attached to the beekeeper bees about 15 years. They were like pets to her. So it is a hobby you get intrigued with, you fall in love with, and for most people, though, it's an average of 7.4 years. But what you're going to be able to come out is come up, take a look at, you know, anything you want, feel it, you know, try it. And then I got all the different honeys. There's coffee stirrers. Take one end, try it, cleanse your palate, go to another one. You'll see that all honeys aren't the same. Honey is not honey is not honey. They all have their delicate flavors. There's blueberry, cranberry, there's mint. Be sure, that's the first time last year I got mint honey ever. The guy's got 3 acres. You need a lot of one crop. And he's got 3 acres, and I got mint honey for the first time in my all my years. It's fantastic. I've saved most of it for myself from last year. I'm hoping to get more this year out there. So it's that's my favorite by far. But you'll see the blueberry. They all have their own taste. Take as many sticks as you want. Try as many different honeys. You want to try the mead jelly? Try that. You want to come here? You can blow on them and you can hear the roar. Just blow on them.
Yeah.
In the gentle roar?
Yeah, that's all I'm saying.
So be sure to do that. You'll see them close up. Look up here, you might be able to find a queen. And come check out everything you want to check out here. I did bring some spring honey into my car. If anybody interested, it's $8 a pound jar, which is a good deal. Library special.
How about beeswax?
Hmm?
Are you selling that?
Comb honey? Yeah. Those are 15. Those are 15 if you want to buy.
I have a question.
Hmm?
How can the bees afford to lose so much product? They've made it to sustain themselves and through the winter, they need a lot, they can't go out. So how can they afford to lose all this wax and honey to?
Well, they make extra. That's the one good thing about bees. We as beekeepers have to know how much to leave. I don't ever jeopardize my bees by taking too much. I always leave them 80 to 100 pounds. The beeswax, they have plenty to have the bees, have the honey, the pollen, and they're young. They got plenty of wax. So beekeeper has to know, to be a good beekeeper to his bees, he has to know what he can take and what he can't. A bad beekeeper will take everything because they're greedy, they want it for themselves, and then the bees die because they starve. So you as a beekeeper will learn that. I've been doing it for years. I know exactly. I love the bees. I'd rather not get any honey and have the bees to live through all to the winter. So I'm one that, bees are my love. And like I said, my wife always says, you spend more time with the bees than you do with me.
They don't talk back.
Well, they stay in them. Well, I taught for 38 years. I taught in high school for 38 years, and then I've been beekeeping for 60-something, and some say, well, what is worse? Well, I said, the kids talk back, the bees stand. Have your choice. So, I love both those books. I had a great career. I did this, I kept my own beehives and got involved in research. After I retired in 2009, I've been doing bee research with Harvard and with the USDA.
How have they decided that neonic is what's killing the bees?
There's a number of issues. There's mites, there's viruses, there's pathogens, there's the pesticides. All this together is taking its toll on the bees. And the bees, when I was a kid growing up, you didn't have to manage nowhere near what you have to manage today because of all these different factors. And that's why the wild bees aren't making them. They didn't have all these challenges. For them to adapt, it takes years and years to do all these new things. And it's going to take them a long time. That's why all the bee trees that I knew when I was, they're all gone. The bees die. Or if a swarm moves in from your bees, it's what? Non-managed. It dies within a couple of years. And so the wild bees are the feral colonies. Oh my God. Yeah, it's sad. Sad to see, a dead hive. I was with one gentleman too. I went to, he called me and said, Ken, can you come down here? Something's going on. I went down here. Well, there was no honey. The bees were barely lethargic, barely moving like this around. They couldn't fly, nothing. So I said, quickly, what? He said, what's wrong? I said, just go mix up some sugar with water. I drizzled it into the cluster. We waited about an hour. All of a sudden, they started coming back to life. I took off the cover after the drizzle. He had tears in his eyes. He said, you saved them. I said, yeah, they would stop. You've got to know as a bee, but no beekeepers, it's hard. He didn't realize. He saw flowers all day, thinks, but see what happens is in heat like this and dryness like this, the flowers are there, the plants to survive with dry soil and intense heat. They close up the nectaries to conserve energy, so they're not releasing any nectar. So the adult bees, well, bees can't go like anything else without eating for very long. And if you saw that one hive, I said, boom, I said, Dave. I says, look, they can't move. They're not even flying up. Like when you open the cover, some of them fly up, and none of them could even fly up. They were maybe 2 days away from starvation. And we saved them. It tears inside that. It was, geez, I'm glad I called. You know, so you get emotional. People get very emotional about their bees, I found, just like pets, like their dogs, their cats, and whatever. So, yeah, any other questions, by the way? I'll be happy to answer them. No, come up here. I can answer questions. Try the different hives, the coffee stirrers. The orange blossom is in a little tube there. I got some. Those are online. Those are some from Florida, some from Washington State, California, all different hives.